The Kraft Foods Company presents The Great Gildersleeve. The Great Gildersleeve, starring Harold Perry, brought to you by the Kraft Foods Company, makers of a complete line of famous quality food products. Now let's see what goes on with the Great Gildersleeve. He comes home in the evening and finds the hall table piled up as usual with everything under the sun.
Confound it, let's clean up this mess here. Leroy? Marjorie? Why must everybody pile everything on this table? Good evening, Bertie.
Dinner's just about ready.
Right away. Marjorie?
Hello, Auntie.
Your hat. Leroy?
Did you call me, Auntie?
Get this out of here or I'll burn it.
Okay.
Hereafter, I want this table. How long has this letter been here?
Let's see. Oh, that came a couple of days ago.
A couple of... Listen, mail is important. Don't you know that? Lying around here for a couple of days. Suppose that was a check for $1 million, Leroy. I'm asking you, suppose that was a check for $1 million.
Why don't you open it and see?
Well. Leroy, have you washed your hands?
I wasn't reading it off.
Have you washed your hands?
Sure.
Well, go wash it.
Okay.
Man has no more privacy around here than... What day is this, Marjorie?
Wednesday.
I mean, what date?
I think it's the 3rd.
Oh, my goodness. Then this is for tomorrow. Oh, that's terrible. It says RSVP. I don't know what she must think of me by now. I'll just have to call her up.
Miss Gildersleeve, dinner.
Bertie, do you know how long this letter has been lying on this table here? 5 days.
At least.
Yeah. Well, confound it, it's time you people around here learned that mail is important. It's not something to be kicked around the house. The mail must go through. That's one of the first principles of our government. That's why tampering with the mail is a federal offense. That's why...
I wasn't tampering with it.
Well, I didn't mean...
Any mail comes, I leave it late. Same with letters and same with checks. I don't touch nothing. Not birdies. Same with money, too. I find any money laying anywhere, I dust around it.
Yeah, well, I'm sure you do. Only...
Yes, sir. Nobody ain't gonna get nothing on Bertie.
Well, I wasn't blaming you for this, Bertie. It's just embarrassing, that's all. A lady sends me an invitation and gets no reply. Makes me out to be very rude. Yes. Well, let's have dinner, my dear. I'll call Miss Goodwin later.
Miss Goodwin, huh? You haven't seen her lately.
Hardly seen her all winter. She's been very busy, I suppose. Just as I've been.
Anybody would be busy who had a whole school full of Leroy.
Yeah, I dare say. This my napkin? Yes, must be. Yes, that's the trouble with winter. People get too busy. But now that it's spring, they begin to relax a little. Yeah, that's what's nice about spring.
I think she's so attractive, don't you?
Hmm? Oh, yes. Very attractive woman, very... Capable, too. Capable and yet, attractive. Remind me to call her right after dinner.
Unky.
Hmm? Yes, my dear?
Have you decided yet about tomorrow night?
Tomorrow night?
I mean about Ben. You said you'd make up your mind later, and I thought, well, as long as you're going out tomorrow night...
Well, my dear, ordinarily I don't approve your going out on school evenings, but just this once, as long as it's spring... And as long as it's Ben.
Oh, Unky.
go ahead. Have a good time, my dear. Where's dinner here? Where's Leroy? Leroy, I told you to come down to dinner.
He told me to wash my hands.
Well, come to dinner. Bertie?
I'm coming.
Hey, you can bring it on now.
What's for dinner?
Never mind what's for dinner. Why don't you wipe your hands on a towel, Leroy, instead of on your pants?
No towel.
Suppose you had no pants. If there's no towel, go get one.
Yes, sir.
Not now. Sit down and eat.
Sit down and eat. Go get a towel.
What,
Leroy?
Bertie, by the way, I guess I'll just be Leroy for dinner tomorrow night. Marjorie and I would both be going out.
Hey, no fair. Hey, what's the idea? Where's she going?
Now, Leroy.
Gosh, everybody gets to go out to dinner but me. I always get left. No fair. It's a have.
Now.
Can I have Piggy over to ask him to spend the night?
That's up to Bertie. You'll have to ask her.
Oh, boy, can I go and call him now?
You haven't asked Bertie yet.
Oh, she always says yes, don't you, Bertie? Boy, that'll be super. Piggy and I can have a neat time. I'm glad you're going out. We can have the whole house to ourselves.
Well, be careful what you do with it, that's all.
Mr. Gildersleeve, excuse me. Are you talking about tomorrow night, Thursday?
Yeah, that's right, Bertie. Oh, my goodness. That's your day off, isn't it? I hate to ask you to change your day off again, Bertie, but...
It ain't that, Mr. Gildersleeve. It's about Judge Hooker's dinner.
Is he coming here to dinner again?
Well, I understood you and the whole family was going over to Judge Hooker's tomorrow.
Not tomorrow, Bertie.
Oh, no.
By George, it is. It's tomorrow. Completely slipped my mind.
Oh, for corn's sake, do we have to go over there?
Can't we get out of it some way, Uncle Roy?
Golly, I'd like to.
We've got to, that's all.
Yeah, gosh, Pick will be so disappointed now if he can't come.
If the old goat didn't make such a great big thing out of it every year, confound these annual customs. Never should have got started in the first place. The whole thing is ridiculous anyway. The idea that I should have to report to him once a year on you children in the estate. That's not what a probate judge is for. Just something the old goat made up.
Sure, what does he know about it, the old goat?
That's not the attitude either. Judge Hooker's been a very good friend to both of you children. And to all of us. It's just that, well, confound it, I've got better things to do.
So have I. Me too.
Well, I don't know how we're going to get out of it this late.
I know. Tell me you're sick.
But Leroy, that wouldn't be true.
Pardon me.
Maybe if you explain to him, Uncle.
I know. I'll tell him I had a previous engagement, only I didn't know it till today. That just happens, young man, to be the case. Now eat your soup.
Gildy, I've ordered the whole dinner. I've ordered a special stewing hen for the fricassee. I've gone to all sorts of trouble.
I know, Judge, and I wouldn't have had this happen for the world. But it was one of those things, that's all.
You know we do this every year.
Oh, I know, but I didn't hear from you, and then this invitation came from me.
Don't twist the facts. You heard from me before you heard from her.
All right, maybe I did.
I know. You don't want to come to dinner.
Of course.
If our little custom means no more to you than that, let's skip it.
Well, too bad. But if he's going to be an old goat about it, well.
Throckmorton.
Hello, Eve. Long time no see.
Oh, gee, and I was just going out.
That's all right. I was going to phone Eve, and then I said to myself, no, I'll just run over there. Because I owe you 1,000 apologies.
What for?
Your invitation. It was lying on the hall table. I never found it till this evening, and then I was horrified.
Oh, you needn't have been.
Oh, but keeping you up in the air that way without an answer.
Oh, I wasn't expecting you, so it was all right.
You weren't expecting me?
Oh, no, Judge Hooker told me you wouldn't be able to make it.
He?
When I invited him. He told me all about your annual dinner.
Oh. Well, about that, Eve, that's all right now.
Oh, I quite understand, and I wouldn't interfere with it for the world.
Huh?
I think it's such a lovely custom. Two old friends sitting down formally to dine together once a year and toasting their friendship on the anniversary of their meeting.
Yeah.
There's something almost classic about it, like Damon and Pythias. Such friendships are rare, Throckmorton. They deserve to be cherished.
Yeah.
So please, don't think I resent your refusing my invitation to keep your engagement with your old friend. I honor you for it. In fact, I wouldn't think very much of a man who didn't.
Well, as long as you understand, Eve. Sorry I can't make it.
Oh, I do, Throckmorton. And after all, what I was planning here was nothing important. Just an evening of fun.
Well, goodbye, Eve.
Goodbye, Throckmorton. Oh, and by the way, if the judge's dinner ends early, stop over later.
It'll end early, all right.
The nicest compliment on your cooking skill is a request for a second helping. And believe me, the whole family will be asking for second helpings if you cook with smooth-melting Velveeta. The rich yet mild cheddar cheese flavor of Velveeta does so much for so many foods. Velveeta puts new life into those Lenten main dishes, fish, seafood, eggs, and macaroni. Or Velveeta makes a glorious cheese sauce for vegetables. And it's so easy. Just melt 1/2 pound of Velveeta in the top of a double boiler. Next, stir in 1/4 cup of milk. Then pour that golden sauce over broccoli, green beans, carrots, or cauliflower. There won't be any leftovers. And speaking of leftovers, even they can be glamorized with Velveeta sauce. Don't forget that Velveeta helps supply high-quality, complete protein, milk minerals, food energy, and vitamin A. And it's as digestible as milk itself. So if you want compliments on your cooking, be sure to get a package of Velveeta tomorrow. It's swell for snacks and sandwiches, too. Genuine Velveeta is the cheese food of Kraft quality. Now let's get back to Gildersleeve. He's had to swallow his pride and ask Judge Hooker to renew his invitation. But weighing the prospects of an evening with the judge against an evening of fun and games at Eve Goodwin's, it becomes clear to him that something must be done. And so...
Yeah, hello, Mr. Gildersleeve. What can I do for you today?
Phoebe, you can do me a favor.
That's what you're in business for. What's the nature of the favor?
Well, I'll tell you. I'm going to dinner at Judge Hooker's tonight. You see, every year he... Well, I won't go into the whole boring business, but the long and short of it is, I want to get out of there. I want to get out of there early.
Something else on the fire?
Never mind. I want to get out, and I need an excuse. That's where you come in.
Where?
I want you to call me up at the judge's house. Wait till about 9:30, then call me to the telephone.
But what do I say?
It doesn't matter. I just want an excuse. I'll say I got an emergency phone call, and I was suddenly called away. Will you do it?
Well, it's a little out of the pharmaceutical line.
Look, Petey, all I'm asking you to do is to make a simple little telephone call. All it can cost you is 5 cents.
Oh, it's not the 5 cents, Mr. Gildersleeve. I know you're good for 5 cents.
Well, what is it, then?
Well, suppose I call up there and Judge Hooker answers. And what's he going
to
say?
You don't have to tell him who you are. Disguise your voice.
How?
Easy. Just make it sound like somebody else. Go ahead. Now try it.
Now?
Now. Go ahead. Let me hear you.
Hello, Judge Hooker. This is Mr. Peavy. Is Mr. Gildersleeve...
Don't say you're Peavy. That'll give you away, sure. Make up a name.
Oh.
Now, try it again.
Hello, Judge Hooker. This is Mr. Smith.
You sound just like Peavy.
Well, no, I wouldn't say that.
And you have to think of a better name than Smith. Look, Petey, can't you fake some kind of an accent or something? Pretend you're some kind of a foreigner?
Well, I boarded with a Swedish landlady once.
Oh, fine. Then you can be a Swede. Yeah, go ahead. Let's hear you.
Hello, Judge Hooker. I've been Master Johnson.
Great, great. Do it that way, Petey. That's great.
But Mr. Gildersleeve, suppose he asks me what I want. What shall I say?
Tell him you want to speak to me. Tell him anything. Tell him my house is on fire.
Your house is on fire.
Yeah. No, that won't do. He can look just down the street there. Well, make up something, Petey. Tell him it's an emergency. Will you do it?
No, I'll try.
Yeah, all right. You're my friend for life, Petey. Thanks. 9:30 tonight now, and remember, you're Swedish.
Let's see. Hello, your choker. I've been Master Johnson. Hello, your choker. I've been Master Johnson. Hello, your choker. Up to Peavy's Pharmacy.
Yes, I'm ready.
You look very nice, my dear.
I think it's perfectly ridiculous wearing my hair like a child just to please the judge.
Now, Marjorie, if it makes him happy. As a matter of fact, it's very becoming. After all, it's only once a year.
Why does everything always have to be the same? It's so boring.
Now, we're all having to give up something this evening. Let's just grin and bear it, shall we? Grin, Leroy. Who's that supposed to be?
Judge Hooker.
Oh, great, great. Are you all ready to go?
Sure.
Let me look at you. Yeah, you look pretty good. Yeah, pretty good for you. You know, you're quite a nice-looking boy when you get dressed up with your hair combed. There's just one thing. You ought to shine your shoes.
Shine my shoes? You can't shine these shoes. They're too beat up.
Well, then put on another pair.
This is the only pair I have.
I buy you a pair of shoes every week, it seems to me. What becomes of all the shoes I get you?
Well, some of them get too small. And some of them get like this. A few get more.
Well, go upstairs and try to find some of the lost ones. If you can't find any, try to polish these a little.
Okay. Just all this fuss for nothing. Chicken fricassee. Doesn't Mrs. Fogel know how to cook anything else?
The judge's housekeeper is a very kind-hearted woman, Leroy. She thinks you like chicken fricassee. Kindly behave in such a way that she will have no reason to change her opinion.
But it makes me sick. If I don't tell her this year, we'll just have it again next year.
You can stand it once a year.
I don't mind the chicken. I hate the carrot soup.
Well, I don't really mind that. It's the prune souffle. Yeah, but we mustn't let the judge know. Remember that.
Uncle Mort, is there any chance of getting away early? I mean, early enough for me to...
I don't believe so, my dear. That is, not early enough for you to go out with Ben.
But there's nothing to do there. You eat and then everybody just sits around beating their gums.
That's the way grown-up people enjoy themselves, my boy. You might as well get used to it.
Gosh, I'd rather be a kid.
I suppose the judge will let us look through his stereoscope. Those dull pictures of Yellowstone National Park.
Well, you don't have to look at them if you don't want to. Join in the conversation.
And listen to the judge tell about how he stole a chapel bell at college. Every year, he tells us.
Well, this year I won't let him. Why, George, there's such a thing as carrying politeness too far.
This is certainly a joyous occasion. I've said that before, and I'll say it again.
Yeah, it sure is.
How about some more of the stewed celery, Leroy?
No, thanks, Judge.
Well, some more of the chicken, anyway. Mrs. Fogel, would you mind going around again with the chicken?
Surely.
Oh, no, thank you, Mrs. Fogel. I couldn't possibly. It's delicious, but really...
Mr. Gildersleeve.
Mrs. Fogel, I just don't dare. I'm known to be devoted to the pleasures of the table. But even I have to draw the line someplace.
Well, Leroy, I guess it's up to you to save the family reputation.
Me?
How about a nice wing, Leroy?
Oh, thanks, Mrs. Fogel.
Leroy, I think you can forget manners for once and have another helping.
What?
Yeah, go ahead, my boy. I'll forgive you.
Well, thanks, Doc, but I'm saving a little room for the dessert. You know what I hope it is, Mrs. Fogel?
Mrs. Fogel isn't going to let you down, Leroy. Good old prune souffle.
Take some more chicken, you little weasel.
Now there's another little ceremony we go through every year. Anybody remember?
Which one, Judge?
The measuring. Come on over here to the door jam, Leroy, Marjorie.
Oh, for corn's sake.
Yeah, come on. Come on.
Now, my guess is that Marjorie has grown the most these past 12 months, beginning to look like quite a young lady.
But these pigtails, really, Judge.
Where's last year's mark, Horace?
I see. Miss Gladys, dear. Marjorie, 1945. There it is. Stand up there, my dear. Head flat against the wall. Anyway, hold still while I make the mark. There.
Where is it?
Right there, over your nose.
What? I've only grown half an inch. Cookie, do you realize what that means?
What?
I've grown up.
Well, you may be right, little Marjorie.
Well, I suppose you'll be going to dances and all that kind of thing in another few years.
In another few years? Why, if it wasn't for this thing...
Yes. Leroy, suppose you stand up there and see if you're getting any bigger.
Are you kidding?
Stand still, young man. No tiptoes now, you little rascal.
Now, don't cheat the boy, Horace. Make the mark level with the top of his skull.
That's level. By golly. He's grown about 3 inches.
3 inches? The gym teacher at school says I grew 3.5 inches since last year.
Well, what does it matter? After all, the main thing is to have a record each year, isn't it? And as long as you're not shrinking, Leroy.
Well, I should say not. He's getting to be a fine big boy. I suppose you'll be going to college one of these days, won't you, Leroy?
I suppose so.
Sending him to your alma mater, Gildy? Or do you want him to get an education?
Now, listen here, you old goat. Just because you went to some little Eastern college that nobody ever heard of, with a football team that couldn't even beat Vassar.
Why, we had an excellent team.
Yeah.
It was an excellent college. And if Leroy happens to have an inclination toward the law, he couldn't choose a better school to give him his foundation. What about it, Leroy? Care to be an attorney? Or a judge?
Nah. I want to be an airline pilot.
Yeah. Plenty of time, Judge. The boy's not even in high school yet.
Well, perhaps I worry unduly. I know I shouldn't. After all, both you children come from fine stock. Your mother was a cultivated, lovely woman.
My sister. Your
father was a splendid man. I know you'll both turn out all right.
Yes, yes.
Throckmorton, perhaps you and I should excuse ourselves and retire to my study for a little financial discussion.
Huh?
Leroy, I know you've been itching to get your fingers on my stereoscope all evening. You and Marjorie can examine the slides if you wish, while your uncle and I have a little talk in my study.
Is this really necessary, Horace?
In my opinion, it's vital.
Oh, well, then come on, let's make it snappy. Only 9 o'clock.
The Grand Canyon. Look, Marge, there's a little guy riding on a mule way down at the bottom. It's probably the judge. I don't want to look at those stale things anymore. I wish we could go home. I'd rather be in bed even.
We'll have to go soon. It's almost 9:30.
The judge has sure got a house full of junk. Why would anybody want to... around the place.
I don't know.
All right, children, put away the pictures. The judge wants to have some kind of a ceremony.
Another one? For corn's sake.
Well, he claims this is a sort of a surprise. Some sort of a presentation, I believe.
I bet it's a book. Why can't we go home, huh?
Quietly, Roy. Soon, if all goes well. Oh, hello, Horace.
Well, children, I have a surprise for you. For each of you. I've been intending to save these until your respective 21st birthday, but I've decided not to wait.
What's that you got there, Horace? Your strong box?
Yep. Open it with a key.
Oh.
There we are. Now, Leroy, I take great pleasure in presenting you with something that was given me by my father many years ago. It's something I prize very highly. And I hope you'll prize it also. It's a gold hunting case watch. Made by Tiffany.
A gold watch? Jeepers.
Well.
Do I get the little leather bag, too?
Yes, that comes with it.
Jeepers.
What do we say, Leroy?
Oh, yeah. Gee, thanks a lot, Judge. Marge, a gold watch.
I think Leroy means to be grateful, Horace. I must say, I don't know why you should give him such a magnificent present.
Well, I have a deep personal interest in these children, Throckmorton. An interest that extends far beyond my legal responsibilities, as I believe you know.
Good old Horace. By George.
Now, Marjorie, I'm not forgetting you. What you'll find in this little box belonged to my sister Hazel. She was an extremely beautiful woman in her younger days. And while she grew a little heavy, she remained handsome till the day of her passing. They're real pearls, Marjorie.
Real pearls?
Horace.
Small, but real.
Oh, Judge. They're the most beautiful things I've ever seen. Oh, Judge, you're a darling.
Now, Marjorie.
A gold watch. Hockey, aren't they lovely? Where's the mirror? I'll look at them on the dining room.
Horace, old man, honestly, I don't know what to say.
A gold watch.
You don't have to say anything, old man. You know that I love these children just as much as you do.
You've been a second uncle to them, Horace. Isn't that true, Leroy? Hasn't the judge been a second uncle to you?
A gold watch and a leather bag.
That's chamois.
Oh, Judge, I don't know how to thank you. Look, Auntie.
Yeah. Why, George, what? Oh, my goodness.
Hello?
Hello, I'd only speak to Mr. Gildersleeve, please.
Mr. Gildersleeve? Just hold the line. for you, Gildy.
For me? Who could be calling me here?
It's Peavy. The man sounds drunk.
Why, it couldn't be Peavy, but I'll speak to him. Hello?
Mr. Gildersleeve, the dam has burst.
What?
I say the dam has burst. This is Johnson.
Oh. Well, I don't care, Johnson. I won't be able to make it this evening. Goodbye.
Not a Gildy. Trouble?
No, it's really nothing. These fellows can't pester me about business in the evening, not when I'm enjoying myself with an old friend, anyway. I was saying to Leroy, Marjorie, the judge has been a second uncle to you children, hasn't he?
He's been wonderful. You're a darling, Judge.
Well, as I say, what the dickens? Hello?
Have I speak to Mr. Gildersleeve for just a moment?
Gildersleeve? Hold the wire. Peavy again.
It's not Peavy. It's a man named Johnson. Hello?
Mr. Gildersleeve, your house is on fire.
I told you, Johnson, I can't be bothered tonight. Goodbye. Darn pest. What were you saying, Horace?
Well, I've been intending to say these things till the children were 21. And I got to thinking. The allotted span of man is 3 score years and 10. Draw? I've arrived now.
Horace, you're not feeling sick.
Oh, no. That is nothing out of the ordinary.
I never saw you looking better. Did you, children?
I think he looks great. I never saw him looking younger.
Of course. You live many a long year yet, old friend. Many a long, happy, prosperous year, I hope.
Sure, Judge. The first 100 years of the hardest.
Leroy means well, Horace.
I know he does. Leroy is...
Let me answer that, Horace. That fellow Johnson, I'll break his neck. Hello?
Mr. Gildersleeve?
Is that you, Johnson?
No, this is Peavy. I just wanted to know if you got the message.
Yes, I got it. Ye gods, what do you think I am, a half-wit? Are you there, Johnson?
Yes, I'm here, but I don't know what to say. This is Peavy.
I'll see you tomorrow, Johnson. But if you see Peavy, tell him to stick to the drug business. Peavy is an idiot.
Well, now,
goodbye! Yes, Judge, I've been thinking. I might send Leroy East to college after all. There's something about those little colleges back there. They're so old and they have such wonderful traditions.
It'd give me real pleasure to recommend Leroy to the Committee on Admissions. Real pleasure.
All right, George, I'll do it. Make a gentleman out of it.
At the same time, I believe he'd enjoy it. I certainly enjoyed my own undergraduate days.
Sure. Say, kid, you ever heard the judge tell about the time he stole the chapel bell when he was in college? Tell him, Horace.
Yeah, tell him.
Go on, tell him. Oh, you'll love this.
Well, it was like this.
Yeah?
There was a little gang of us.
Yeah, I remember.
We were sophomores at the time. One night, we all...
There are millions of crippled little girls and boys and grown-ups, too, who will find better health, occupation, and joy this year because of the aid and comfort you give in your purchase of Easter Seals. When the mailman brings your envelope of Easter Seals, you will know that whatever you give will go to bring comfort to 500,000 crippled children, about 7 million crippled adults, and nearly 15,000 war veterans. The National Society for Crippled Children and Adults has 42 state societies working to make this silver anniversary Easter Seal campaign its most successful.
The greatest investment one can make is an investment in human life. You can invest in the life of crippled children by keeping your quota of Easter Seals. Good night, folks.
Have you tried Kraft's delicious prepared mustard? They're really different. Creamy smooth for easy spreading and blending, seasoned with extra care to bring out that true mustard flavor. For the folks in your family who like a mustard that's mild and delicately spiced, the variety to buy is tangy golden Kraft salad mustard. And to please sharper tastes, there's another popular variety, the Kraft mustard with snappy horseradish added. Why not buy both kinds? Get them flavor fresh from your dealer tomorrow. Ask for Kraft horseradish mustard and tangy golden Kraft salad mustard.
This is NBC, the National...